is when we sing together, then Krishna manifests much more easy. Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati is also. Both is important, kirtan and japa. But from the two, kirtan is more important if we sing with a full surrender, of course. Why is that? Because there is nothing more convincing for Krishna to give mercy if devotees nicely work together. Your own kirtan is nice, but it's not impressive if you don't know how to connect with the devotees. It's a common sense, it's a simple thing. And in the kirtan together, this is the perfect opportunity to come very close. Although we are sitting all separately, but we will come very close with each other. Isn't it? And very harmless, very pure-hearted. Still, we are very close. That's what keeps me going for 25 years. And just that feeling together, singing together, and then it emanates for days and days and days. If we really put our mind on it and our heart on it, because these two types of singing, we will touch that a little bit, what Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati says about kirtan. That's awesome. But we sing again something. Jayaranda Madhava Kunja Bihari
Jayaranda Madhava Kunja Bihari
Jayaranda Madhava Jayaranda Kunja Bihari
Yasodhananda, 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 Yasodhananda,
Για μόνα τη
such a way that we can understand why Prabhupada is like he is and why he was so successful, where he gets his inspiration, and how totally connected disciple and guru is. We get some glimpses. As we hear, we can recognize things, why Prabhupada does things as he does. I will go through this whole life history of the main points, but before that I want to give some impression about intensity of Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Maharaj. I think for most people of the world, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati is too much intense. I will read you some points. Don't fall flat from your chair or from your sitting place. It is extremely concentrated nectar. But this intensity indicates that intense love for Krishna, that intense, pure love for Krishna. And without this, the jiva cannot exist. And the pure devotee sees through all this, immediately recognizes all this illusion, all this boring materialism, thick hanging on the head of every conditioned soul, like us. So they are beyond all this, and they are bringing in pure love for Krishna. And then they say, "Why, my God, these people don't understand anything, even in the name of religion." So then he started to use a certain language. It's very strong. And many, in the beginning, it's difficult to digest all this. But that's why we should talk on this regularly, so we have a better understanding of that mood. So I start with two quotes. Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati, the theist, the atheist and the theist, right? The theist is by no means enjoined by the scripture to be a non-violent, passive spectator of the violent acts of aggressive non-theists against Vishnu and his devotees. Small commentary on this. Because Kali Yuga is all about totally covering the Vedic culture, and the essence of Vedic culture is Krishna consciousness, the worship of Vishnu in his pure heartedness. The last symptom we saw is with the Mahabharata, an enormous war was fought simply for the point of protecting pure bhakti. They went into physical things also. Devotees are not scared for anything, provided it is done with a total pure motivation. And after that, again, after Maharaj Pariksit, it went down like anything. The pure principles of Dharma. See? So, immediately the demonic forces has taken over Kali Yuga for the last 5,000 years. And what is that? Simply they have to obscure this pure knowledge. And then they can play any nonsense. And nobody will figure out what's going wrong, what's going right. See? So, Bhaktisiddhanta calls this, in the name of theism, in the name of religion, in the name of God, they are atheists. And they are extremely aggressive. To understand that more, you can read the article of Bhaktisiddhanta called The Putanas. He has written an amazing article on the pseudo teachers of religion, the false teachers of religion, and they're everywhere. They're also in Hinduism, they're also in Buddhism, they're also in Christianity, they're also in religion, they're also in the democratic system, they're in the communist system, they're everywhere, sabotaging in a first class way. So they're very aggressive non-theists against Vishnu, just like Hiranyakashipu. No? We can compare the whole systems of today, secularism. You can have your religion, but don't open your mouth too strong, right? So they have expertly sabotaged this whole thought processes of people. All of us, we are contaminated. Even as devotees, we are extremely also contaminated by these thoughts, and it takes many, many, many years or maybe lifetimes before we get really clear on this. So for that it is so good, for myself I see, it is so good when I read Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati's statements, it's really, I'm a little bit sleepy, and we're all sleepy Kali Yuga Bhaktas, doing something, we are doing something, yeah. And then when you read it, it's like, you wake up, and that is totally required. If anyone wants to be serious in Krishna consciousness, this treatment has to be there. If you think we just come in bhakti to relax, then you'll never make much progress. You have to take it with your life and soul. Whether you live in the temple or you live outside the temple, that doesn't matter. It's the mentality by which you take up bhakti. So, like this, the devotee, Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati, the taste, taste means devotee, right? He cannot be a silent spectator of all this nonsense. Okay, it's Kali Yuga, we cannot do anything. We just do our own small thing and for the rest we keep quiet. So this is not good, he says in this text. The taste is by no means enjoined by the scripture to be a non-violent, passive spectator of the violent acts. Why it is violent? They are not using physical violence. No, the biggest violence is atmahatya. Depriving the people of the understanding that they are a spiritual soul. There is not more violence than this. Physical violence is nothing against spiritual violence. And what is that? The Brahmastra of atheism, what is that? Darwin theory. We are all a product of matter. We are not smart enough to understand it, but simply, somewhere or other, these molecules are so brilliant, they move like mad. You see, this is happening, this is happening. And we are just a product, life is a product of matter. And this way, they can totally break the faith into God. Break the faith that we should be something spiritual. No. They're not important at all, spiritual. It's all your dream. These people who talk about soul and spirit, they are so sentimental people. They don't have brains enough. They are dreaming, they are fantasmic. It's all mythology. So like this, they break the faith in the spiritual dynamism. Even amongst devotees, I see so many devotees there. Like this, there is no enthusiasm. They're just coming in a routine. This is not devotee. There's nothing to do with devotee. Just trying to understand what is devotee, not yet being in devotee. Devotee is jumping around like anything. Very enthusiastic, smiling, shining. Because he's always in close association of Krishna. Krishna is life. Krishna is full of life. That's why in the kirtan, we don't sing very silent. We sing full hearted. Let all the energy come out and get purified. It's never required. This Kali Yuga, thick darkness sitting on our head all the time. And we have to shake it up. And another expression is in this way, that we have to come out with this pure knowledge of the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna consciousness, and share it to others in any way we can, in our own capacity, with our own pure desire. This is not the meaning of the teaching of the Supreme Lord Sri Krishna Chaitanya, to be a passive spectator, by which the devotee is required to be humbler than a blade of grass and more tolerant than the tree. These qualities of humility are to be exercised in upholding and not for deserting the cause of the truth. No, I'm a beautiful, I'm a humble devotee, so I cannot involve in all this. This is false humility. If you really become humble means, I'm a servant and my master is so good and he's the master of everybody. And how they have sidetracked my master, this is humility. I cannot tolerate this. This is real humility. For ourselves, we are humble. But when it comes to protecting the position of Krishna, we become very active. So that is the move of Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati throughout his life. So once upon a time, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati had to confront one of the big scholars in Calcutta, very big brain, very big professor, very well known, and he had to confront him in discussion of the Vedas, whether it's impersonal or personal, whether Vishnu worship is supreme or not. What is this Chaitanya Mahaprabhu? What is this movement? Who is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu? So many Hindus are challenging this, that he's not a very important personality. So, for that, Bhaktisiddhanta took the challenge. Of course, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati, he was known as a very most brilliant being. And he had a show a few times. I will explain that later on. And so everybody knew he's not just some useless bhakta in the eyes of some people. Bhaktas are just sentimental people who cannot do anything. So he defeated this in the university while so many people were watching the debate, and he just gave the right arguments and he just was defeated. So after that, Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he gave a message to Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati, and you hear what he says. You will be undefeated everywhere in presenting Vaishnava Siddhanta. If in propagating the straightforward unbiased truth, then the entire anti-devotional, misguided, self-interested world community unites all together to attack you. Still, no one will be able to muzzle your fearless voice. Never desist from preaching the truth. We know from Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he had the other line. His mood was try to reach out to all types of organizations and philosophies in Hinduism, and try to touch the good points in every philosophy and like this pull them towards this pure bhakti. That was the strategy of Bhaktivinoda Thakur. But finally, he got some success because he wrote a lot of books where he wrote very carefully the Siddhanta of pure bhakti, right, according to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And he was an administrator, so he immediately set up very powerful organizations to protect Gaudiya Vaishnavism. No? But still, at the end of his life, he saw that all those who had come had again become Mayavadis. Then he got a dream of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu that, now it's enough for your life. These people of Kali are too stubborn. You don't preach anymore. Just go in Samadhi and chant for the rest of your days. And that's what he did in Jagannath Puri. And later on, somebody will come to pick up again. We know who is that. It's Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Maharaj and Srila Prabhupada. So he saw, because Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati was so dedicated to Bhaktivinoda Thakur. Although Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he was the father of Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati, but they never dealt like father and son. Bhaktivinoda Thakur was seeing to Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati, this is a pure devotee sent by Krishna in my family, in the womb of my wife. So I have to train him, I have to give him the mission. And Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati saw, I have been born in such a great family, my father is such a pure devotee, I have to be his disciple. They always dealt with each other like guru and disciple. So then Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati, he says, I have two eyes. And these two eyes, one is Bhaktivinoda Thakur and the other is Gaurakishore Das Babaji. And for the rest, I don't have eyes. I don't see anything in this world. This is disciple. This is bhakti. Our consciousness, we have all kinds of eyes. We have hundreds of eyes, right? We are seeing so many things. But not Bhaktisiddhanta. This is called Ekeha Kurunandana, single mind. And the other is Bahusaka, many branched. But then you cannot shoot a target. You cannot hit anything. There are too many things. You have to become single mind. So there's Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati. So Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati saw that the strategy of his father finally had not given the full effect. So he took another mentality. He said, I'm gonna challenge anything what is less than total pure bhakti. He calls it, actually already Bhaktivinoda Thakur had put an organization called Sudha Bhaktivani Siddhanta. That's a concept. Not just bhakti. Sudha bhakti. Pure bhakti. Not just pure bhakti. Vani. The total characteristics of pure bhakti. Vani. And not only just some instruction on pure bhakti. Siddhanti. The perfect conclusion which defines the principles of what is pure bhakti, so nobody can play anymore with concepts. This is called science. Perfection of science is spiritual science. Unless you enter into spiritual conclusion, there is no question of science. The real information comes when you pass beyond matter. Matter is just a small effect of the whole phenomena of existence. real science, if you start to understand the principles of the dynamics of spirit, there we in the West we are extremely bad in that. We don't feel it, how spiritual dynamics works. We are really dull in this. We know how matter works, and we think matter, spirit works like matter. And that's why we have so many clashes. Yeah. So, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati, he was an, he's a real scientist. So, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati took this strong point that he will, in his writings, he preached with writings. He preached with magazines. He was all the time writing articles on whatever happened in the newspaper, whatever happened in the universities, which spiritual organizations there, which political things, immediately writing, and analyzing the points. And then acknowledging the good points and defeating the bad points, right? And of course, if you present the pure Krishna consciousness, the purity of the spiritual world, you know, where you... It's not welcome in the material world. The idea is welcome, far away, the spiritual world. But then if it comes to following the consequence, to entering the spiritual world, that's another subject. Then we have to transform a lot. And who is ready for that many times? So Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati, he took that out of compassion. And he says, if you read my text, it will seem extremely hard. But if you read it carefully, you will understand it's extremely soft. And that's an amazing statement. Because one of the professors, a lot of the educated people in Calcutta, they were coming to the discourses. He also had his headquarters in Calcutta. And his aim was directly the educated people. Prabhupada, he took both the influential people and the masses of people. That's why he pushed book distribution. So it's the same principle, but according to time, place and circumstances, they know how to preach. But in the beginning of 1900, there were not so many magazines, so if you write a magazine that time, everybody will read it. And then there was much more control of the intellectuals, so if I can catch them, I can change Calcutta, I can change Bengal, and if I can change Bengal, I can change all India. Right? So then, many intellectuals, because he was known as very bright and very brilliant, he was once upon a time the head of the University of Astrology, because he knew the astrological science perfectly. Later on, he desisted on the order of Korkeshwarajarabhi. So he was giving discourses on so many important subjects, and especially Krishna consciousness. And then the intellectuals, they came to hear him, like we're sitting here, right? And some of the professors say, Swamiji, your language is so complicated. Why don't you keep a dictionary next to us that we can? Your language is so complicated. Why don't you talk more Bengali than English or something like that? You know what Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati answered? He says, my language, what I speak, is neither English nor Bengali. My language